I'm Dave Moreland. Welcome to this introduction to the visual arts. I'm calling it Musings on Art, Aesthetics and the Human Experience. When I was a teacher, I always began my first class with a drawing. And the drawing will help us begin this journey into the world of art. I also want to listen to a little music at the beginning of each of these lectures. So let's start here with a little music from Dave Brubeck, part of his Take Five, and I'll do the drawing. Okay, that's the drawing. Here's another one that's maybe a little bit better. I always ask the students, what is this? What could you imagine it to be? I get answers like a cage, or a trap, a torture device, sometimes a chandelier. I say, could you wear it? Someone will say, well, like a crown. And I say, yes, maybe like a very exotic Viking crown. I say, what's it made out of? And usually I get the answer, metal, because of the little round circles there, or the rivets that hold this object together. And I ask, what color is it? Well, it could be almost any color. Most of the guesses are silver, gray, metallic blue. Then I ask, what do you think those lines around the outer edge imply? What do they suggest? People will say light or movement. Sometimes I get the answer, energy. Here's another version that I did, where the color is a little stronger. I hyped it up in Photoshop, red hot to white hot. I like to describe those lines around the outside edges there as the aureola, the energy field that surrounds all living things. Then I say this, it's a metallic burning bush. And usually I get someone who says, oh, the Bible. You're making a reference to Moses when he goes up on the mountain. God speaks to him through the burning bush. And I say, yes, but really we've come some long distance from the actual object. I've transformed it quite a bit. Here's the real thing. It's what's known as a bottle rack. It comes from France. It was a device used for drying out bottles. They'd be turned upside down and hooked over those projecting hooks there. Well, in the early part of the 20th century, this artist, Marcel Duchamp, he was part of an art movement called Dada, and they were intent on, well, tearing everything down, making non-art, trying to change the direction of art and art history. So he decided that he really didn't need to make the object. All he had to do was find something and then declare it to be work of art, which is what he did with the bottle rack. He called it a ready-made. Well, that causes a problem because throughout history, we think of art as being something that artists make with their hands. And he was saying, no, we can just do it with our minds, art by designation. Maybe we should begin this first section with a few big questions. Probably the first question we should ask is, what is art? It's a difficult question, not easily answered. Saul Steinberg's cartoon here will help us initially. It's a word that describes certain things. Like here, we can look at it, think about it, and maybe even walk around it. Let me give you a dictionary definition for art. Art is a branch of learning, one of the humanities. Well, the humanities is the study of human beings or human nature, language, history, philosophy, religion, the visual and performing arts, literature, all the things we think of as part of our culture, what we know and what we believe, our way of life, what we call the human condition. Another important question would be, why do we make art? Let me give you another definition. Art is the use of skill and imagination in the production of things of beauty. Here's another Saul Steinberg drawing, a man drawing himself and a rather wild extension, letting his energy and imagination flow out and around him. Another definition. Art is the expression of what is beautiful or beyond ordinary experience. Here's Picasso doing a drawing with light in the air. Can you make it out? It's a rather loose and expressive image of a bull. One more definition. Art is intentionally made by humans and imagined before it is made. Can you see the bull? The front leg and the hoof, the horns there at the top? Here's a man looking up at some images of rather large bulls. Do you know where he is? He's standing in the famous Hall of Bulls, which is in this cave, famous cave Lascaux in France. These images were made by prehistoric humans. These are deep, dark caves. This is obviously lit artificially, but the cave artist had to provide what light they could from torches or oil lamps. So the question is, how, or maybe more importantly, why would they do this? The animals were a part of their natural environment. These people were hunter-gatherers. Apparently, they would return to these caves generation after generation. They were like sacred spaces. Here's a different image from another cave, the cave Chauvet. It wasn't discovered until 1994. Here we have horses, rhinos, aurochs. These images must have been made as part of a ritual. And these spaces were like sanctuaries. Remember the definition: art is intentionally made by humans and imagined before it is made. Here are some rhinos. Pretty scary and intense. I like to think that the ritual, the magic in these paintings, had a very powerful effect on these people. Maybe they had to do with initiation ceremonies or rites of passage. No one knows for sure. Let me move to a different image. Here's a man and a woman. Who might they be? Where do they come from? The way they're dressed and the objects they hold give us clues. Also, the cracks running across the surface of the image give us some idea of the condition of the painting and the materials. What if I said they died in a natural cataclysm? Well, they're Romans. They lived in Pompeii, and so they died in the eruption of Mount Vesuvius. This is a fresco painted on a plaster wall, probably a wedding portrait. He wears a toga and holds a scroll. She holds a tablet and a writing stylus. So they're both supposedly educated. I enjoy their human qualities. They're rather pensive, but intent on getting to know one another in their new relationship. Maybe it'll take a while. What about this couple? Who are they? Where do they come from? Do you know the title? Do you know the artist? You've no doubt seen a parody or two of this painting. Here, a Beavis and Butthead take off. These are things that make us laugh and think about our culture in various ways. The Simpsons. Here, a more recent Trump and Hillary take off. And, ooh, something dark. This one has the actual title of the painting in it. It's called American Gothic, and the artist is Grant Wood. We would call this painting iconic, meaning it's symbolic of certain things. America in the early 20th century. Rural, conservative, a farmer and his wife. It obviously resonates with people in different ways. It depends on who you are and where you come from. The title, American Gothic, makes reference to the window in the house, a pointed Gothic arched window. This is Iowa. I grew up on a farm in Iowa. So it has a particular resonance for me. My father wore bib overalls like that, and I wielded a pitchfork just like that. The models for the painting were Grant Wood's sister for the woman and a local dentist served as a model for the man. They don't look any happier than the people in the painting. Let me show you two more Grant Woods. This one's called Stone City. It looks a little bit like rural Frederick County. And here, a painting called The Appraisal. A woman from town has come out into the country to purchase Sunday dinner, bargaining for that chicken. Here's an artwork with an American icon as its subject matter. This is Andy Warhol's Marilyn diptych. Let me give you another definition of fine art. Those arts considered to be purely aesthetic and or expressive. Aesthetic has to do with beauty. What is considered beautiful? It's really a philosophy that goes back to the Greeks. And expressive has to do with feelings. What causes an emotional response? Does it make us feel happy or sad? We could say that art is one person's vision of what it means to be human, expressed in a particular medium, like this painting, and then shared with others. Now that implies that there is some kind of communication going on between the artist and whoever he or she is sharing their work with. In this case, that's us. So what is Andy communicating here? Something about Marilyn Monroe and her life. On the left, we'd have to say that's the movie persona, the beautiful face repeated over and over. And on the right, a different Marilyn, black and white, kind of fading away. Art is not always easily deciphered. Now, Warhol was initially known for his images of Campbell's soup cans. What's he communicating here? How delicious Campbell's soup is? The beauty of a Campbell's soup can? The label? Maybe it's more about American culture, mass-produced goods. Anyway, Andy had his own definition for art. He said, art is anything you can get away with. Here are four views of a really large outdoor environmental artwork. It was created by the artist Christo and Jean-Claude. It's called The Umbrellas. Now, when we're confronted with a new art experience, we might begin to ask, why is this art? What does this mean? What's being communicated here? Well, on the left are blue umbrellas. They're in Japan. The yellow umbrellas are in California. They were thinking about issues of land use and people's relationship to the environment in these two very different places. Here's another work of theirs. This one's called The Running Fence. It came up out of the ocean. It's in Northern California. The fence is made out of fabric, and it was 18 feet tall. Here's Christo standing next to the fence. And it meandered across three different counties over private lands. Does it remind you of anything? What does it conjure up in your mind? Maybe the Great Wall or a border fence? Robert Frost, in his poem, The Mending Wall, said, something there is that doesn't love a wall. But then he went on and added, good fences make good neighbors. Like all of their work, this running fence only existed for 2 weeks, and then they took it down and recycled all the materials. I watched a movie about this once, and there were a couple of farmers who were dead set against having this artwork coming through their land. Finally, they acquiesced, and near the end of the film, the farmers were standing up next to the fence, and one of them said to the other, "I don't know if it's art or not, but it sure is beautiful." Maybe he was seeing his land with fresh eyes. Here they are again. They're standing in Central Park, where they created another environmental artwork called The Gates. This happened in February of 2005, and I was lucky enough to be able to go up to New York and see this artwork. It's a sculpture, an environmental work, and like their other art, ephemeral, short-lived, like a butterfly. Crystal would make drawings, proposal drawings, idea drawings. This is what it would look like. And then they would use these to try and convince, like in this case, New York City, to allow them to go into the park and create the work of art. Remember the definition, art is made by humans and imagined before it is made. It stretched for 23 miles throughout the park. They thought of it as a gift to New York City, hoping to remind everyone of the beauty of Frederick Olmsted's original design for the park. So art is imagined before it is made. I like this as an image for the imagination at work. It's called The Architect's Dream by Thomas Cole, 19th century American painter. Here we see the architect reclining on top of a huge column, imagining the history of architecture. I like to say he's musing or being inspired by what has happened in the past. Maybe he's a little worried. What will he do? Can he borrow or combine these previous styles? Or is it possible for him to create something brand new? I like the fact that Cole signs his name here on the top of the column. Here's another very imaginative painting. I'm sure you know this work. This is Van Gogh's Starry Night. It seems to reveal both a conscious and subconscious level of imagination. It expresses the wonderful oppositions of nature, earth and sky. The night sky has come alive with swirling, glowing stars and galaxies, and in the center is a spiraling convergence that, when I emphasize it, you can see becomes the Chinese symbol for universal oppositions, the yin and the yang. Now, mankind is small in the face of nature. The town seems to cower below. The little church steeple reaches up past the horizon and touches the sky. But more dramatically, that huge tree reaching like a black flame, a kind of dark omen. Like all great art, it seems to transcend its own time and speak to us directly. It provides us with something deeply felt and speaks to the core of our humanity. Van Gogh was good at that. Let's return to the question, why do humans make art? We could say that art fulfills certain purposes or functions. Now, one purpose has been to provide us with a visual record of things in the world, like this painting by John James Audubon of a wild turkey, or Albrecht Dürer's depiction of, well, earth and grass. This is just called the Great Piece of Turf. Or here, another Dürer, a careful rendering of a bird's wing. Dürer was really good with details, like with this rendering of a rabbit. He gives us a really precise and careful rendering of what this rabbit looked like. This is what Venice looks like, or did look like, in the 18th century. This is a painting by Canaletto. He's showing us the arrival of the Doge. In his red-roofed barge, he's coming back towards his palace, the Ducal Palace. And here we are, looking up along the Grand Canal. Or we can go into the Plaza and look at the palace, the Ducal Palace here, and St. Mark's on the left. Or here, St. Mark's Plaza. These paintings were known as vedute, or view paintings. People making the grand tour of Europe could come to Venice and buy one of these as proof that they had made the journey and had been educated as a result. Here's one more view, looking up the Grand Canal towards the Church of the Salute. These paintings are sparkling in their detail. Another purpose of art is to make our feelings visible to others. Here's the famous painting by Munch called The Scream. Obviously, there's some angst here. It became a symbolic image of man's trauma as the modern world got underway. Here's another one of his emotional paintings called Anxiety. In contrast, here's something a bit more uplifting. This is Chagall's birthday. I like this. A bouquet has been given, a lover's kiss, and now they're floating up in ecstasy. Or here, Dufy's homage to Debussy. The music seems to permeate the room with a pleasant encounter of complementary color and line. Another purpose of art has been to represent spiritual or metaphysical ideas. Metaphysical pertains to the essential nature of the human mind. What is reality? What are the things that exist above and beyond the physical world? Things transcendental, spiritual, and abstract. Like both of these artworks are expressions of religious beliefs. Christianity's Michael the Archangel on the left, and the enlightened Buddha from Thailand on the right. Images like these are intended to offer guidance and help us comprehend the meaning of life. Here are two mandalas. On the left is a sand mandala from Tibet, related to Buddhism. On the right is a Vishnu mandala from India, related to Hinduism. A mandala is a geometric representation of the universe. Circles and squares, perfect geometries combining to create a symbolic world view. This is the famous Aztec calendar stone. It would have originally been painted in very strong colors. The Aztec believed that human sacrifice was necessary in order to appease the sun and the cyclical nature of existence. The great rose windows in Gothic cathedrals were symbolic of heaven and the cosmos, all revolving around Christianity and the idea of resurrection and eternal life. Here are some Tibetan monks making a sand mandala. They do it as a form of meditation. This is a part of their ongoing pursuit of enlightenment. But as soon as they're finished, the sand is swept up and gathered together, put in a little urn, and then dispersed in the river, symbolic of the cyclical nature of existence. Both of these artworks are expressions of the Japanese belief in Pure Land Buddhism. The monk Kuya on the right is chanting his praises for the Amida Buddha, who presides over a Western Pure Land paradise. In the Raigo painting on the left, the Amida Buddha is welcoming another soul to paradise. A painting like this was shown to a person near death so they could connect with the Amida Buddha by repeating the chant, "Hail to Amida Buddha." I like the way the sculpture depicts that chant, as six little Buddhas emerging from the monk's mouth. "Hail to Amida Buddha, hail to Amida Buddha." Let me show you a few more Raigo paintings and play you some music. Shakuhachi is the instrument. It's a flute. And tamuke is the music, which is like a prayer for the dead. Playing the music is like a form of spiritual meditation and prayer for the safe passage of the soul. Let's listen to a little of this music. Thank you. Architecture certainly serves the function of providing spiritual and metaphysical experiences, like the Taj Mahal on the left, a place for transcendence, or the vaulted ceiling in the Alhambra Palace in Spain, where the physical really seems to dissolve into the ethereal. Or here, the prayer hall in the great mosque in Cordoba in Spain, a wonderful open and spiritually convoluted space. Or here in Paris, Sainte-Chapelle, with its wonderful stained glass windows, creating a space that again seems to transcend the physical and get us closer to the spiritual, closer to heaven. Another purpose of art is to help people see the world in new and innovative ways. Now, these two paintings, Albert Cuyp and Claude Lorrain, are realistic depictions of harbor scenes. Both show the accepted way of showing light reflecting across water. And then in the 19th century, Claude Monet painted this, and everyone became upset. Critics complained that it was unfinished and didn't qualify as art. But Monet was showing the world a new way to see with fresh eyes. He was emphasizing the validity of our momentary perceptions. He sought out subjects that would look different each time we observed them, like the train station in Paris, with its glass roof and steam and light. Things were always changing. Let me show you two more versions of this same subject, where everything is completely different. Each moment, things are moving and transforming. My favorites are the haystacks out in the country that he painted at different times of the day and under different kinds of weather and atmospheric conditions. You can see that they have a dramatic difference depending upon the temperature, the amount of light, where the light is coming from. Here again, a single haystack that, when seen at different moments, appears to be a completely different color. I have a hill near my home, and when I drive to work, I would always look at that hill and think of it as my Monet hill, because each time I looked at it, it was different. He did the same thing with this church facade, Rouen Cathedral. Each time, very different. He's thinking about the light and how it bounces off the surface of the church, and how that light causes different color kinds of sensations. One critic complained that the paintings were so bright that it hurt his eyes to look at them. Here's a photograph taken by the 19th century French photographer Mare. Now, he took some pictures that showed the world a new way of seeing. A man walking. Do you see him? Here he is again, only this time he's moving a bit faster. Actually, what we're looking at is a man dressed in a black suit with white lines sewn to his outfit. So the photograph is really just an image of those white lines as he moves in front of the black wall. And depending upon the speed of the camera, it can become more and more abstract. what we call a time-lapse photograph. Of course, we're more used to seeing things like that these days. Here's a time-lapse photograph of a ballerina. One other way of thinking about this would be what David Hockney shows us in his photographs. Individual shots, single images of an ice skater, superimposed, giving us a different way of thinking or a different way of seeing this kind of movement. He did the same thing with portraits. Here's a self-portrait with multiple single images recombined. Here's a portrait that he did of his mother. Do you think that as a result of these multiple images, we have a deeper, more penetrating kind of portrait? It certainly makes us think about that face in different ways. And here's one more, his desk with things placed on top. Another important function of art is for our enjoyment. Here we have some dancers, which certainly express this idea of joy, a couple dancing a Lindy Hop, what the French would refer to as joie de vivre, or the joy of life. Matisse had the idea to do a painting about the joy of life. This is his first sketch, a rather abstracted view of trees and water. He was a part of an early movement called the fauves, or the wild beasts, where they use very flat, strong color. He wanted to have people in this landscape enjoying themselves. So here's his second sketch with figures placed out in and around the landscape. And here's his final version of The Joy of Life. You can go see it in the Barnes Collection in Philadelphia. We might think these people are having a little bit too much fun. Nude figures embracing, reclining, dancing and playing music. It's like a bacchanal, a modern bacchanal. Everything is simplified into lines and shapes and intense bright colors. It's definitely a fauve painting. Let me show you something from Spain that relates to this idea of the joy of life. A little bit of a flash mob performance in Sabadell in Spain.
Thank you.
That's Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, the final movement, the Ode to Joy. Beethoven was totally deaf when it premiered in 1824. He conducted the orchestra. It's now become a worldwide symbol for peace and human rights. Joie de vivre. Art can also have a political or social function. This is a painting by Horace Pippin. He was a self-taught artist, what we now call a naive or folk artist. As an African American, he was concerned with the social and political circumstances of black people. This depicts the abolitionist John Brown going to his hanging. Here's a work called Mr. Prejudice. Pippin had served in World War I, and then near the end of World War II, he painted this. Black people had adopted the V for victory in the hope that after the war, they would find victory over racism and discrimination. A black statue of liberty looms over a white man here, splitting the V. Here's another painting, Sunday Morning Breakfast, really a depiction of poverty. And here, a painting entitled Holy Mountain. It's like a peaceable kingdom, but there are dark overtones here. In the background, amongst the trees, are grave markers and soldiers fighting in the background. The date here, June 6, 1944, is D-Day, when the Allied forces landed in Normandy. Here's a painting that a lot of people recognize, 19th century French artist Delacroix, Liberty Leading the People. It's about a post-Napoleonic revolt in France when the constitutional monarchy of Louis-Philippe was established. There's a female figure, meant to be symbolic, waving the French flag as she leads the people up over the barricades, those who have died. Her partial nudity is a dramatic device. It's also meant to symbolize truthfulness. Here's a logo. Maybe you recognize this image from the Broadway production of Les Miserables, Andrew Lloyd Webber's musical version of Victor Hugo's book. The red, white, and blue of the French flag dominate things here. Here's a painting that was done just before Napoleon came into power. It's an image of the Romans, painted by Jacques-Louis David. It's called The Oath of the Horatii. Three brothers here are swearing on their swords to go and fight three brothers from a different city. Problem is that there's a love connection between these two families, and the women are grieving, already feeling the inevitable consequences of the battle between these men. Now, David and Beethoven were contemporaries, and both were caught up in the ideas of the French Revolution. Let me play you just a little bit of Beethoven's Symphony No. 5, Fourth Movement. I think the emotional conflicts in the painting are also expressed in the music.
Thank you.
Okay, that's just part, obviously, of that music. But the virtues in the painting, courage and patriotism, triumphing over feelings of love and sorrow on behalf of the women, are kind of like the contrasts in the music. Beethoven was known for his strong, loud, and then soft contrasts. Now, David went on and became Napoleon's chief imperial painter. And he did this famous portrait of Napoleon, which hangs in the National Gallery of Art in D.C. However, when Napoleon proclaimed himself as emperor, Beethoven angrily removed Napoleon's name from his Third Symphony and renamed it the Eroica. And Beethoven predicted that Napoleon would become a tyrant and trample underfoot the rights of men. Another function of art is therapy. Art has the ability to promote healing and a sense of well-being. This is a Navajo ritual healing ceremony. The sand painting on the ground will work its magic, along with the shaman who's chanting. He's on the left there with the patient on the right. This is a Navajo night chant. It's all about returning to beauty and healing. The painting will actually be destroyed as a part of the ceremony. Here's another Navajo healing ceremony with a painting on the ground and the shaman working with a sick child. Music is especially powerful in its ability to help us heal. I like this old photograph of World War II Russian soldiers who have found a piano in a bombed-out building. And they let the music help them in this awful time and place. People now make careers in the field of art therapy. I found this cartoon, which is a rather humorous way of demonstrating how a little art can go a long way in helping us feel better. Another function for art is as an artifact, a product of a particular time and place. This is the famous harvester vase from the pre-Greek culture of the Minoans. It's a small ritual vessel, but it tells us a lot about the people who made it, how they felt, and how they lived their lives. It shows a group of men going to work in the fields. As they walk along, they're singing, following the lead of the man there holding a little rattle, a sistrum. I always think they are on their commute, enjoying the music. It's functioning in a therapeutic sort of way. The instrument itself, the sistrum, is an artifact. Here's one that was found in Pompeii. These can be traced back to Egypt, where they were used in ceremonies worshiping the goddess Isis, the goddess of fertility. Here's two details from Egyptian frescoes. Let me just add that art doesn't need to have a function or a purpose other than to exist for its own sake. What has become known as art for art's sake? This is an example of that. It's a painting by Frank Stella from the 1970s. It's called The Empress of India. Now, this artwork concerns itself only with artistic things, what we call the formal elements, line, shape, color, things that I'll discuss more thoroughly in a later lecture. Let me just say here that after the Renaissance, up until modern art, most people thought of a painting as being like a window through which we looked to see an illusion of reality. This is a shaped canvas, so we can't really ever think of it as a window. Stella called these paintings uncomplicated paintings. What you see is what you see, is what he said. Funny, no one here in this photograph seems to be interested in looking at the painting. Let me come back to Duchamp's bottle rack, which questioned the whole idea of what art is. This brings me to the issue of how do we talk about art? How do we evaluate it? How do we know if it's any good? Now, one way is to listen to experts, someone who knows a lot about art. This is a collage by the early 20th century American artist Arthur Dove called The Critic. Well, it's a rather humorous take on a critic. He wears a top hat and a monocle. I guess he's sophisticated and intelligent. His body is cut out of a newspaper article, a critique. Why is he on roller skates? Well, I always think if he says something bad, he needs to get away quickly. The vacuum cleaner? Maybe he feels like he's cleaning up the world of art. But good art criticism is not just saying negative things. Beyond value judgments, it should be an insightful, descriptive analysis. It should be an attempt to understand and appreciate the artwork. Two critics can disagree, but they should have well-considered reasons for their personal value judgments, whether they give it a thumbs up or a thumbs down. Now, as we begin to think about this idea of criticism or analysis, let me suggest that there are two different approaches here. One is called formal and the other contextual. By formal, I mean only what you can gather from the artwork itself. Things like how it's made, what we think it communicates to us. And by contextual, I mean other information, outside information that we wouldn't know that might affect how we look at the artwork and think about it. The artist's life, the politics surrounding the artwork, etc. Let's try the two different forms of criticism on this painting. Géricault's Raft of the Medusa. Now, under formal criticism, we would say this is a big painting. It's 23.5 feet wide. So here I am making it bigger. Here it is in the museum. You can see people looking at it. This gives you a really good sense of its scale. We would call it monumental. So what can we say? What do we see? First, formal concerns. It's a dramatic scene with people on a raft at sea. There are dead people falling off the raft. Others are waving desperately. Maybe they see a rescue ship. It's a pyramid of people. The wind is blowing up some big waves. It's really rough. Obviously, it's a desperate situation. Strong diagonal movements. The lighting is dramatic. There's very little or minimal color. Well, let's shift over to contextual analysis. This was based on a real event. The ship, the Medusa, went down off the coast of Africa. The incompetent aristocratic ship's captain ordered 149 passengers and crew onto a makeshift raft. The captain and his officers put themselves in the lifeboat and then tied a rope to the raft, which broke or was cut, and the officers made it back to shore the same day, but the raft tossed around on rough seas for 2 weeks. There were only 15 survivors, and they gave rather horrifying accounts of the insanity and cannibalism that occurred during this ordeal. Here's his first sketches for the idea for the painting. He interviewed the survivors. He went down to the morgue and studied bodies. He went to the insane asylum, and he painted these portraits of deranged people so that he could have empathy with the problems of the people on the raft. Here's his first oil sketch, which he modified in a second composition to make it more dramatic. Here's the whole thing again. If we look closer and feel the scale of this painting, it is a powerful image of man struggling against nature. Obviously, I think the best kind of criticism or analysis is a combination of these two, the formal and the contextual. Here's a man finally waving at the top. Does he see a ship way off there, a rescue ship? Maybe we could try this painting. It's Van Gogh's bedroom at Arles. What can we say here in terms of formal criticism? Well, it's a painting of a big bed in a bedroom, yellow bed, very neat and clean, paintings hanging on the wall. The floor seems to be tilting out at a dramatic angle towards us. The color is strong in this painting. What about contextual? Well, we know about Van Gogh. He had come to Arles. This is in Arles. And he was anticipating a visit from Gauguin. So he wanted to have things all neat and clean. He's practicing things that he learned about color in this painting. He's using complementary pairings, red and green, yellow and violet, blue and orange. And he has that heavy, thick paint application. Obviously, we could say more things about both of these artworks. Well, next time, I'm going to have more to say. I'll be talking about the nature of art.